Whenever there is talk of a game being downgraded, you can count on the backlash having one overriding theme. Consoles are to blame. For example, look at this comment left below our Witcher 3 analysis. Thank you, consoles, for every downgrade ever made. Is there any truth to this? Yes and no. For a start, consoles don't downgrade games. Developers do. Nevertheless, PC players argue the only reason developers downgrade their games is because consoles are too weak to keep up with the PC. That doesn't mean the PC version has to suffer the fate of its console ports, though. Researching this, we found that each case was different. While all downgrades share similar circumstances, some are more sinister than others. To demonstrate what we mean by this, let's look at factors that might cause developers to downgrade their games. There are four factors involved in the development and potential downgrade of any multi-platform game: the developer, the publisher, the console manufacturers, and the console hardware. Ultimately, it is always the developers that implement the downgrade, though I doubt a downgrade is ever their first choice. What makes each case different are the circumstances that make them do so, which is where the publishers, consoles, and the console manufacturers come in. There is only one case where the console hardware is directly responsible for a downgrade: console exclusives. Let's look at 2013's Forza Motorsport 5 for an example. This is the only situation where the other factors, budget constraints, the publisher and the console manufacturer, can be eliminated as the cause. Microsoft, who happens to be both the publisher and the console manufacturer, would obviously prefer their exclusive to be the best it can be to provide yet another reason to purchase their console. Since this is one of the console manufacturer's first-party titles, we can rule out budget constraints as well. As no developer would want to downgrade their game, it's reasonable to assume Turn 10 pushed the game as far as the console hardware could handle. With the console manufacturer as their publisher, the developer must have had all the resources they needed to squeeze every last bit of graphical fidelity from the hardware. But the console just couldn't cut it, at least with the original build. As the game was not available on any other platform, the constraining factor here would be the console it was exclusive to. Exclusives' unavailability on the PC leave developers no option to preserve the original, undowngraded build, and this is why exclusives are the only case where downgrades can be blamed on console hardware. Let's move on to multi-platform titles that had their PC version downgraded. The most common argument PC players make is that consoles are too slow to run the original build demonstrated at the game's first reveal, which is almost always run on a powerful PC. This is hard to refute, as the original PlayStation 4 and Xbox One launched in 2013, meaning their hardware specifications were finalized over half a decade ago. Obviously, this cannot compete with the power of modern PC hardware, and thus consoles need a simpler version of the game to maintain playable performance. While this does make downgrading a necessary evil on consoles, this does not mean that console hardware is responsible for the PC version of the game being downgraded. Even if the game needs to be simplified for the consoles, it doesn't mean this gimped port should be the version delivered to the PC players. Ideally, developers should keep the compromises contained to the console ports and continue developing the PC version true to their original vision. I don't think this is too much to ask for, as several games have already been made with this approach to great success. Let's look at Battlefield 3 for an example. There are several reasons I adore this game. Chief among them is DICE's refusal to let the limitations of console hardware hinder the experience on PC. How do we know this? From console players remarking on how different the experience is from the PC version. The console ports are restricted to 24 players for one session, while the PC version supports up to 64. Indeed, if there were any compromises made, they were on the console versions with the lower player cap. One such compromise which DICE had this to say about: if we had more players on console, you might have to take away vehicles because there's a lot of data that has to go through the network and the CPUs. If you had more vehicles, that would mean less players and vice versa. Additionally, map sizes were reduced for the console ports, a design choice DICE justified with this statement: when we say they are smaller, it's not that we have cut them in half, but we tried to compact them slightly to keep the action up. If you compare it to Battlefield Bad Company 2, the maps weren't really small on console. We actually had huge maps even for console. We have the same kind of angle on it right now in Battlefield 3. This is the approach to development we wish was standard across the industry. building the game for the PC without any compromise to the initial version. Graphical fidelity and other features may then be dialed back for the console ports if it is necessary to maintain playable performance. If such compromises are made, they should not be transferred over to the PC build. Even if the uncompromised game is too taxing on contemporary hardware, the PC is a modular platform that can be upgraded, thus sparing the game from any compromises, allowing the game to reach its greatest potential. If not immediately upon release, then at least a couple of years down the line when hardware is improved to the point of being able to render the game in its unfettered glory. Games that are allowed to retain their most demanding settings tend to be way ahead of their time. Want an example? Just look at maps like Bandar Desert, Alba's Mountains, or Armored Shield. If you weren't familiar with Battlefield 3, you would never believe that these maps were introduced in 2012. Even though I played Battlefield 3 for years, I still think these maps can pass for content released in 2016 or even 2017. It was a completely different story on consoles, though. In addition to the drastically reduced player cap, there were complaints about the game looking terrible, with a few, including Angry Joe, going as far to say that Battlefield 3's console version looked worse than Bad Company 2.
It should be mentioned, though, that you were doing yourself a huge disservice if you buy this game on the consoles. Not only do the graphics take a big hit, but the game looks downright ugly in certain parts. In fact, there's also considerably more lag, rubber banding, spawn exploits, and other crashes that's not present in the PC version. And how the Xbox version can even look worse than Bad Company 2, I have no idea.
It is remarkable that the PC version looks as good as it does, considering the game was also released on last generation consoles. The lighting, textures, particle effects and level of detail on vehicles and character models still hold up to this day, because the PC version was shielded from the cuts inflicted on the console versions. Sadly, not all developers give their PC ports the same dedication for reasons ranging from unfortunate to downright sinister. In both cases, though, the PC version is not exempt from the compromises made for the console ports. Ultimately, it is always the developers who implement these downgrades. You might ask, why would they choose to degrade a game they had worked so hard to develop? In some cases, time constraints or perhaps a lack of foresight. For an example, let's look at Dark Souls 2. Compared to the build first revealed to the gaming community, the final version of Dark Souls 2 had considerably degraded lighting and texture quality. The publisher and developer released a joint statement to explain this discrepancy. Throughout the game development process, a game is constantly being balanced not only in game playability, but also in the realm of resource management. That's not exactly enlightening. But it does imply the original build was too demanding. But for what platform, though? It took an insider to answer this question. This is what it comes down to, a playable frame rate. The early builds that the screenshots came from were playable, but only just so. The game was not in a state where it could be sold at that point. I strongly suspect that they were focusing heavily on delivering a top-notch experience on PC and underestimated the challenges the new systems would pose on PS3 and Xbox 360. That's my analysis anyway. But factually, the early builds played like Blight Town the entire game. I sincerely don't think they intended to deceive, but in the end, they sacrificed a huge amount of graphical fidelity at the very end of development because they couldn't resolve the frame rate in any other way. At first glance, you might take this as proof of consoles forcing yet another downgrade on the PC platform. However, a closer inspection leads to a more nuanced perspective. For a start, the early build the game was downgraded from was demonstrated on the PlayStation 3, not PC. Perhaps this is what the insider meant by the entire game playing like Blight Town, an area in the original Dark Souls that was notorious for its poor performance. We think the insider meant the top-notch experience the developers were focusing on for PC ran like Blight Town on consoles. We presume high-end PCs wouldn't be affected as much since PC hardware was way ahead of the last generation of consoles at that point. So that begs the question, why didn't they ship the pre-downgraded build to PC? Considering the huge sacrifice of graphical fidelity was made at the very end of development, the game should have been, at this point, finished, fully playable and free of bugs or instability, even if it may have been very demanding. We think PC players wouldn't have missed out on much had they received the pre-downgrade build. We don't think consoles are to blame for the downgrade of Dark Souls 2. We think the developer is at fault for not looking at console performance sooner. Dark Souls 2 is an anomaly, though. Downgrades are usually the result of the publisher's decisions. You might be thinking, why might a publisher resort to downgrading the PC version? Short answer, money. In some cases, the publisher doesn't have enough resources to develop the PC version separately, and thus changes made to the console ports affect the PC version as well. Let's look at The Witcher 3, for example, a controversial downgrade we've covered more thoroughly in a previous video. This is what the co-founder of CD Projekt Red had to say. If the consoles are not involved, there is no Witcher 3 as it is. Developing only for the PC, yes. Probably we could get more in terms of graphics as there would be nothing else. That would be so focused. Like if we would develop only on Xbox One or PlayStation 4. But then we cannot afford such a game. That wraps up this case, right? Consoles couldn't render the original version. Developers were too broke to preserve the original version for the PC. Case closed, right? Well, it would have been if CD Projekt were upfront about the downgrade leading up to the game's release, but they weren't. They repeatedly denied mention of a downgrade, even while players were noticing the game looking worse with each subsequent trailer.
We are not downgrading it. We are optimizing the game, but in a way that doesn't affect the visuals. We didn't really have any problems with developing for Xbox and for PS4 and for PC at the same time. We really pay attention to for the game to look as best as it can on and the same on all of the platforms.
Notice how this contradicts what the co-founder later went on to say. Developing only for the PC, yes, probably we could get more in terms of graphics. To be fair, they were probably coached to say this by their PR department. A standard practice in the industry, as we've explored in the Ubisoft model. Be sure to watch that video after you finish this one. If you want an example of this with The Witcher 3, just look at the community lead responding in the affirmative to a gamer asking if the scenes in the VGX and Shadow of Destiny trailers can be replicated in their graphical fidelity on the final product with high-end PCs. That was a bold-faced lie. Considering he said this in January 2015, well after the downgrade was implemented and was confirmed by the studio head a few months later. The rendering system after VGX was changed. The VGX he's referring to was held in December 2013, but we have evidence that proves the renderer was changed before June 2013. To learn more, be sure to watch our analysis of The Witcher 3's downgrade, where we list the effects that were downgraded or outright removed by comparing the trailers to the final product. Shot for shot. Speaking of which, now would be a good time to respond to feedback from that video. Whenever the Witcher 3 downgrade is brought up, there's always a crowd of CDPR loyalists who have a number of excuses to downplay the issue. It's just graphics. Who cares? The game was great anyway. Yes, The Witcher 3 is a great game. Possibly the greatest game ever made. Yes, CD Projekt has probably done more for the PC platform than any other company. But none of that excuses how they lied and misled gamers who placed their trust in them. They even blamed YouTube compression to distract gamers who had noticed clear degradation of visual fidelity in their trailers. You can easily debunk this by downloading the uncompressed version off Gamerside. The downgrade is clear as day, regardless of compression. At this point, the downgrade isn't even the biggest issue. The developer's dishonesty is far more disturbing than any degradation in the game's graphics.
We didn't downgrade it. It means yeah. We didn't downgrade. It's impossible. It's impossible to downgrade a game that didn't exist before or wasn't playable before.
Nothing justifies lying to your customers over and over when you know their suspicions are true. What's even sadder, a gamers who still downplay CD Projekt Red's deceit. You're just arguing against your own interests as a consumer. There are still a few who argue the downgrade was necessary for the PC version. Here's a couple of examples. The downgrade make the game playable on average spec PC. Not everyone has a high-end rig, you know. This is why the option menu exists in PC games. You should be able to go into the graphics menu and turn down as many settings as you need to reach playable performance. All games are, by definition, downgraded on their lower settings. This doesn't mean the game should be downgraded as a whole. Indeed, the entire purpose of configurable options is to preserve the original undiluted version on the higher settings, even if these maximum presets cannot deliver playable performance at the time of the game's release. The PC is a modular platform that can later be upgraded with newer, more powerful hardware, hardware that can render the game's original visuals at an acceptable performance. Until then, players can finish the game on a lower setting that still looks great, even if it can't quite measure up to the higher settings. When they finally acquire hardware that can run the game at its higher settings, it gives them another reason to revisit the game. But sadly, downgrades discard the original vision entirely and give the Ultra label to settings that deserve it best high or even medium. This is standard procedure across all downgrades. Nevertheless, some downgrades are judged more harshly than others. A double standard that has not gone unnoticed in the gaming community. For example, look at this comment. It's okay when CDPR does it, but not Ubisoft. It is ironic that The Witcher 3 gets a free pass for its downgrade, when Watch Dogs is widely reviled for the same move, even though Ubisoft didn't bother to scrub the original effects from the game files. Sadly, this was not the case with The Witcher 3. There is no way to retrieve the incredible fire, smoke, and skies seen in the original trailers. Many would say The Witcher 3 had far better writing, characters, and narrative than Watch Dogs, as if this makes the downgrade any less impactful. It is possible and in fact preferable to critique The Witcher 3's writing, voice acting, characters, story, gameplay and visuals separately. Excellence in certain aspects does not make up for deficiencies in others brought on by a downgrade. Furthermore, nothing makes up for lying to your customers. If you think the downgrade and deceit doesn't matter because The Witcher 3 has great writing, characters, story or whatever, think about what lesson developers and publishers take away from this. That it's okay to lie to your consumers as long as your game excels in other areas. That you can get away with blatant deceit if your game ticks enough boxes. This is a dangerous message to send to the gaming industry. We think there is only one sensible approach when it comes to downgrades.
Either all of them are okay, or none of them are okay.
We lean towards the latter.
None of them are okay.
With that said, this impartiality doesn't extend to the multitude of ways publishers can be monetarily influenced into downgrading their game's PC version. In more sinister instances, the publisher has a financial incentive not to let the PC version be the best it can be. To demonstrate, let's look at a publisher notorious for downgrades, Ubisoft. While Ubisoft has downgraded several of their titles on the PC, some of these downgrades have been investigated more extensively than others. Let's begin with Watch Dogs, the first of Ubisoft's downgrades to spark considerable attention from the gaming community. This is the reason Ubisoft cited for their downgrade from the visuals originally showcased. One thing to remember is that the first showing of Watch Dogs came in summer 2012, before anyone knew what the next generation of consoles and hardware would be. We did our best at the time to predict what they would be and always were forward that this first showing was running on a very powerful PC. The most powerful PCs in 2012 would have been something like an i7-3770K with multiple GTX 690s or 7990s, though I doubt they would have used quad SLI as it was reported to be buggy and unstable. Watch Dogs wouldn't be released until 2014, by which time the GTX 980 should have delivered comparable performance to the very powerful PC Ubisoft used to showcase Watch Dogs before its downgrade. 2014's hardware should have been powerful enough to render the 2012 version. Well, we know it was capable because players were able to use them after all. How? Modders managed to retrieve the removed effects and reactivate them to little detriment. Ubisoft released this statement in response. The dev team is completely dedicated to getting the most out of each platform, so the notion that we would actively downgrade quality is contrary to everything we've set out to achieve. Rubbish. We'll have proof of this in a moment. You were saying? We test and optimize our games for each platform on which they're released, striving for the best possible quality. The PC version does indeed contain some old, unused render settings that were deactivated for a variety of reasons, including possible impacts on visual fidelity, stability, performance and overall gameplay quality. Modders are usually creative and passionate players, and while we appreciate their enthusiasm, the mod in question, which uses those old settings, subjectively enhances the game's visual fidelity in certain situations, but also can have various negative impacts. Those could range from performance issues to difficulty in reading the environment in order to appreciate the gameplay, to potentially making the game less enjoyable or even unstable. Is that all there is to it? Perhaps not, as a leak from Ubisoft Insider painted quite the different picture. As you know, when the first Watch Dogs review was published by that one site, Ubisoft called it a false review, and I'm sure everyone can see how bad that sounded when they saw the game did look marginally better than something that was released last generation like GTA 4. The Insider was referring to WCCF Text Review, which arrived 10 days before Ubisoft's embargo. WCCF Tech reasoned they were not bound by Ubisoft's embargo as they had obtained their own copy, but Ubisoft put out a tweet calling the review fake nonetheless. Coincidentally, this is what the review had to say about Watch Dogs graphics. The visual fidelity is definitely not on point to E3 2012. Without big explosions, which makes sense, and the daytime looks bland and equivalent to Grand Theft Auto V, a last generation title which was highly optimized. We wonder if that was a factor behind Ubisoft calling the review fake. Ironically enough, the Insider called rubbish on the reasons Ubisoft cited to justify the downgrade, namely possible impacts on visual fidelity, stability, performance and overall gameplay quality. But no, they will not admit that they practice this or actively downgrade a game. It is much easier to say they remove things for stability, which is often a lie, as you can tell by the post issues which are expected in any production we do. They will never fully disclose what was removed from what build, as no laws ask them to do so in terms of consumer rights. If we as developers publish that information in very real terms for the consumer, such as replace particle fog simulation with 2D layer simulation in 3D space, remove particles from all explosions, lowered explosion volume multiplied by 20 times, removed X number of trees and civilians, etc., we would be out of a lot of sales. And probably it would actually require too much time to deliver on the current hype that a lot of downgraded games see, which look incredible with a vertical slice. We understand why the leaker felt the urge to be so specific. It must be heartbreaking to be forced to degrade the beautiful visuals you've spent months on or even years crafting. Indeed, this is what the Insider said about his motivation behind his leak. I do share this in the hopes that my colleagues and publishers and a lot of people who make false promises and do demonstrations which wrongfully create too much hype that they cannot deliver on, ultimately stop doing such things. I want to see the industry actually move forward and not be so full of itself by promising too much and delivering too little. It shouldn't be surprising to learn that these revelations were part of a larger leak, blowing the whistle on another downgrade that was in progress. The Division, to be specific. We really loved the reception to the demo we showed on the PC version at E3. Currently, as it stands, there is definitely a lot of push coming from publishers to not make the experience so different on consoles as to alienate players into thinking that next generation is not as powerful as PC. This is probably what happened at Ubisoft Montreal. I think that while making stability changes is definitely important, it does not completely obliterate a lot of enhanced rendering applications. Right now, we already took out quite a lot of screen space reflections from the game and are working on asset management the best we can, given consoles have that great unified memory. Naturally, we will also be using online servers and have to produce a synchronization that higher graphics add to the latency, so it had to be turned down. To me, it still looks good, but not as good as the original reveal. I'm sure as we get closer to launch and the actual console versions of the game featuring SD, Snowdrop, that it will start to seem all too obvious to people, especially those on PC. I just want to write and let you know that it definitely is not just stability, but marketing politics plays into this a lot as well. While, yes, the lead platform is the PC, we simply cannot have such a big gap. This exact reason was confirmed on record in a 2016 Q&A session prior to the game's release.
As a game dev, do you guys ever get like restricted based on consoles, like as far as what you can do, just because it's like, we know we could do this on a PC, but we have to make a game for consoles too?
It is definitely a benefactor in it. But one good thing about The Division is we've always considered the PC as a separate platform. I've worked on projects before that the PC versions are ports from a console, so it carries that limitations over, but we've always been in the mind that we'll have a dedicated PC build, so it hasn't really held it back too much.
That's awesome.
We do have to kind of keep it in check with the consoles. So it'd kind of be unfair just to push it so far away from them.
A closer examination suggests there are other, more insidious incentives for Ubisoft to downgrade their PC ports. More specifically, This case highlights the role console manufacturers play in influencing publishers to downgrade the experience. On The Division, Xbox had a deal with Ubisoft, and part of that deal was to ensure that the PS4 version did not look better than it. The resolution, frame rates, and density of assets could have been higher on PS4, but this was vetoed to prevent issues with Microsoft. As sad as this is, I don't see why Ubisoft had to extend the downgrade to the PC version. I get why Microsoft would want to erase proof of their console's inferiority, though it is pathetic to pay a bribe just to cripple your competitor's customer experience. But this is all part of the console war. Why did Ubisoft drag the PC version into this? Did the deal with Xbox also oblige them to cripple the PC version? Let us know what you think in the comments section below. In summary, it's always tragic when a game is downgraded. Games are not just a product sold at the market. They represent years of blood, sweat, and tears on behalf of the developers. As such, these games stand as a testament to the developers' legacy. To then have to downgrade the game doesn't just discard years of their hard work. It permanently tarnishes the only legacy they leave behind. Once a game is downgraded, it's extremely unlikely its original glory will ever be recovered. Admittedly, remasters are a fairly common practice in the industry, but so far, no downgrade has ever been reversed with a remaster. It is an imperative for consumers to keep a keen eye out for downgrades and never give a free pass to any developers that resort to this shameful practice. If you agree, please share this video to raise awareness of this. There is more content like this on the way, so please like, subscribe, and press the bell button to know when it's out. We have a secondary channel that serves as a backup, so please subscribe to it and remember to press the bell button. While you're here, feel free to watch the videos referenced previously. Analysis of Ubisoft's model, The Witcher 3 downgrade, and Denuvo's history and performance impact.